What's up, everyone? Joe Carroll here. Excited to be with you guys today because I have what I was told is probably the ultimate vocal compressor. Who isn't excited about that? I'm looking for anyone to raise their hands. No one raised their hands. If you're very excited to find the ultimate vocal compressor, raise your hand. Okay. That said, what I have today is sitting right here on my left, and we can zoom in on it, is the Hazelrig Industries VNE compressor. Now, what makes this unique? Well, first of all, maybe you've not heard of Hazelrig. I think they're relatively new to the industry, so let me tell you a little bit about them. The name you probably have heard is DW Fern. So that is highest of the high-end stuff. That is Cadillac, that is Rolls-Royce. You don't see it very often. It's very expensive. But I've been in a few very, very high-end studios, and when you see that bright red in the rack, you get up close enough to realize it's a DW Fern, you're excited, because that is going to be one of the best preamps on the planet. You know, I have got to use their EQ as well. Stunning. Just absolutely stunning. But I have never been able to use one of their compressors. I've been told it's just, you know, everything that you would ever want it to be. But I've not had the chance to do that. But Doug with DW Fern has teamed up with Jeff and George Hazelrig, and they've kind of worked together now. So they share information, they share technology, marketing, distribution, manufacturing, things like that. So Hazelrig is also, as DW Fern is known for, making the highest end stuff possible. So this is not going to be an inexpensive piece of gear, but for those of us that's looking for the absolute best of the best, this name is going to creep into play. It's going to be part of our everyday terminology. And what I'm interested to do is put this thing in action and hear it on some vocals. I'm sure it sounds amazing on a lot of things, but if I'm going to spend a lot of money on a compressor, it's because it does lead vocals incredibly, right? That's how we make our living. If we make that singer happy and that producer happy, that their artist sounds like a star, we get hired and rehired. So it's very important. It's a very important thing for me. That said, what makes this different? Let's talk about it just for a minute. And as you can see, it's fairly unassuming looking, just a handful of knobs. It isn't something that's going to take us a long time to understand and to figure out how to get amazing results. Because there are, let's face it, there are other pieces out there that are very expensive, well-known compressors that are not user-friendly. This, while maybe not as user-friendly as an LA-2A, it's not a lot more difficult as well. Now, on the inside is where things get really different. Yes, we have a transformer. We have a Jensen transformer. Yes, we have tubes. We have four of them, 6072As, to be more specific. But what makes this thing different? Whereas we know terms like VCA, we know terms like FET, we know terms optical, we know variable mu, we know how, we kind of understand how they apply the compression, how they achieve compression, and kind of also know what they sound like. You know, if we hear the term VCA, we know, right? We know what they do. If we hear optical, just the word alone tells us a lot about how this is going to sound and how it's going to act. This is a unique animal because it uses what you call pulse width modulation technology. So I know there's some of you that are going to be like, what does that mean? How does that work? This is not going to be the video for you. You're going to be able to do a deep dive on all of that stuff somewhere else because it's kind of, some of that stuff can get really over my head. I'll just admit it. What I care about is how does it sound? So that said, I thought I would bring up a couple different vocals. I have a female pop vocal here, my friend Mackenzie Johnson. Thank you, Mackenzie, for letting us use your work here, and everybody should go follow her and stream her music. And this is a song, it's just really mainstream pop, but now we're going to look at the vocals here, and we're going to see that they were recorded very dynamic, very, very dynamic. In fact, we'll just listen. I've got the top vocal unmuted because all it has on it is a little bit of EQ, just a little bit, because the vocals were a little dark coming to me, and just a touch of de-essing, not very much, but it's substantial at times. So, you know, just to make it just a little more pleasing. All right, let's listen to this in action. Ooh, chase him down when it's no good. Wouldn't have to risk it all because he would. let's talk about these words right here, and right here. I mean, they really jump out. It doesn't sound like a record at all yet.
Ooh, he would be the first to go. Wouldn't have to risk it all because he...
And you hear right here, you hear risk it kind of gets lost. So this is really loud. This is really loud. This is really quiet.
Go, wouldn't have to risk it all because he would.
And also right here, listen to the tail of this word. So she's going into an incredibly cool vibrato on the ooh, and the listener needs to hear that. That's a big part of the emotion of the track. So that intercompression, right? That's what it does. However, typically, what compression does is it can be grabby in a way, and it can be very audible. Sometimes we love that, right? We love the grabbiness of a compressor. We love the fact that when it really digs in, the tone gets darker. You know. Tonality kind of changes as it's doing its thing. Sometimes that's cool and sometimes it's not. I know for my first step of compression, I really love compressors that are as invisible as possible. And when I was talking to our friends at Hazelrig about demoing this unit, what they told me, their description of pulse width technology or pulse width modulation was, it sounds like an incredibly skilled engineer with his finger on the fader. No tonality changes, nothing but pure volume changes. And that got me excited because who doesn't want that? I mean, you know, in their bag of tools. So let's unmute the track here, and you'll see it's the exact same track. Just, I have a hardware insert going, so it's going to be this one right here, with the compressor enabled. So let's dial something in, okay?
He would, ooh, chase him down when it's no good, no good. Ooh, ooh, he would be the first to go. Wouldn't have to risk it all because he would.
Gosh, that sounds really good right there. And I got like 2 whole seconds into it. Okay, maybe 10 seconds. That said, something I want to point out on the front here. Let's look at the metering. As you'll see, it's light. It's not a VU meter. And the first 7 dB of compression are pretty much one for one with the light. So we'll count all the way over here to 7, and we'll see it's this light right here, right underneath the letter A. And the last 3 lights make up the additional 8 dB of compression. We see up to 15 dB of compression on the scale, which is, that's a lot, right? So the last 3 lights, when those are kicking in, we know that that's in somewhere in the 10, 12, 15 dB range of compression. So let's see, let's kind of play with it a little bit more here.
He would, ooh, chase him down when it's no good, no good. Ooh, ooh, he would be the first to go.
Speed it up just a little bit more.
He would, ooh, chase him down when it's no good, no good. Ooh, ooh, he would be the first to go. Wouldn't have to risk it all because he would.
Okay, to me, that is amazing. What I'm going to do is I'm going to go to this track right here. We're going to listen to this. This is the uncompressed version, okay?
Ooh, chase him down when it's no good.
Now, let's hear this with, it looks like probably around 12 dB of compression max, which I know is heavy-handed, but as you can see by the waveforms, we need that type of control on this track.
Ooh, chase him down when it's no good, no good. Ooh, ooh, he would be the first to go. Wouldn't have to risk it all because he...
Wow. Okay, so what I want to focus on and draw your ears to is how not loud this right here gets, and the vibrato on this ooh, which is, to me, is it's gorgeous. Like, I want to hear that. I really want to enhance that for the listener. In fact, I'll probably get my finger on it and write it up at the end of that phrase. Check it out one more time without compression.
No good. Ooh, ooh.
Now with compression.
No good. Ooh, ooh.
So I can hear the ooh. Now listen to how loud. Listen to how loud the word right here is.
Ooh, he would be the first to go.
That word, call.
Ooh, he would be the first to go.
Now let's check it out with compression.
Ooh, he would be the first
All of a sudden, we have this incredible bed to set our vocal down. And a lot of times, the way I mix a lot of times is I really love having a very transparent, you know, finger on the fader sounding style of compressor as my first insert. And then I'll follow it with the character that I want. For example, I know what a Blue Stripe 1176 does. I know what a Blackface 1176 does. I know what a 3A, what a 2A, what a Varimute does. And as you can see, I'm surrounded by racks of incredible tools. That said, this would make an amazing tracking compressor. I'm never going to paint myself in a corner with this, ever. Like, whether I'm getting 3 dB of compression, whether I'm getting 10 dB of compression, it's going to be inaudible. The tone's not going to change. It's, as long as I have the attack and release set in the ballpark of correct, I'm thinking it's going to go to tape beautifully. But on mixing, if I get something this dynamic, I'm going to patch this in first, let it print, or patch this in and then go right into, for a song like this, probably a Distressor or a Blue Stripe to get the character of that piece. And I'm going to be able to lock a track down exactly where it belongs. So we'll see here. Where are we at? We ended up with a kind of a medium fast attack, kind of a medium fast release. Most of the words are very short and kind of punchy, you know, to fit the pacing of the song. So I don't really want to slow it down and take the energy. If I slow the release down too much, it's going to take energy from the attacks of the following words. And we want this to sound punchy. But also, I'm going to point out right here on the front something I haven't talked about. We can bypass the compression. We can engage the compression. Or we also do have a high pass filter built into the sidechain to keep unwanted pumping and the low frequencies from you know, causing massive compression at times. But right now for the vocals, I'm just going to keep this off because most all of these vocals were already high passed prior to the compression. Okay, so that's what it's capable of in a song like this. What I want to do is I want to switch to a song where the let's call it the emotion and the liveliness of the vocal is vital to the, you know, to the message that the song is selling. So what I have pulled up now is a song from my friend Gloria Anderson. Some of you that watch my content regularly or watch the Produce Like a Pro channel may remember this. This was recorded exclusively with a Moog Pre-Q2, all the instruments, all the vocals and everything. And these multi-tracks are available as a download if you'd like to mix them on the Produce Like a Pro channels. Just look up Joe Carroll Mixing Country, I think it's called. I'm going to make sure we're listening to the uncompressed track. And you'll see it dynamically. She sings very dynamic, but it's a dynamic form of music as well. And it's not compressed all that heavy. In fact, I don't know if we tracked with any compression just so people could really hear the sound of the preamp. So let's check it out.
Well, I didn't know I'd be more than the things you see. And it wasn't easy in the beginning getting to know me.
Gosh, what a voice. Every time I hear her sing, I want to call her and say, hey, do you want to record again? She's amazing. So again, that's Gloria Anderson. Gloria, thank you for allowing us to use your vocal on this demonstration, and go check her out and follow her on social media and all of that good stuff. Okay, so now let's bring up the compression track, and let's see if we can dial something in. And again, because of the form of music that we're working on here, it's going to be something different than what we wanted to do on Mackenzie Johnson. That's a punchy pop thing, so a fairly fast attack, but also a faster release. This, we're probably going to want to slow up the release a little bit, make it a little more buttery, and we want enough of the attack popping through that you hear her emotion. One thing you will notice is that she's got a beautiful, beautiful clear tone, and so that's where a pulse width modulation piece like this, finger on the fader type of compression, would come in really handy to preserve all her natural beauty. And let's see if it's capable of doing that. Here we go.
Well, I didn't know I'd be more than the things you see. And it wasn't easy in the beginning. Well, I didn't know I'd be more than the things you see. And it wasn't easy. Well, I didn't know I'd be more than the things you see. And it wasn't easy in the beginning getting to know me. Sometimes I can't see past all the good.
Okay, so I'm seeing about 6 dB of compression. This isn't the form of music that we're going to crush like a pop track. You know, there's a lot more space for for dynamics, you know, to make it, to keep it emotional. But just because we're wanting to hear really what this is capable of, I'm going to go just a little above that.
Well, I didn't know I'd be more than the things you see. And it wasn't easy in the beginning getting to know me. Sometimes I can't see.
Okay, I see a solid 7 dB of compression. So now let's remind ourselves of what her tone, without thinking about settings, let's remind ourselves of the tone and the performance on the uncompressed track.
Well, I didn't know I'd be more than the things you see. And it wasn't easy in the beginning getting to know me.
Same thing that we encounter. I mean, just the regular thing, right? This is way too loud. This is not loud enough. This is kind of bright. The tone is bright, which makes it sound pretty loud. And right here, we're losing her again. And we want all of these little things with a vocal like hers are huge, huge, huge to selling the emotion of a song like this. What a beautiful song. I think she wrote this as well. So now let's listen to the compressed version.
Well, I didn't know I'd be more than the things you see. And it wasn't easy in the beginning getting to know.
Wow. Okay, so it still, to me, it sounds amazingly like her. All the brightness, all the energy is still there. I'm not hearing any roll-off happening as the compression is kicking in. So the whole finger on the fader analogy is really working for me. There's a couple spots I want to listen to. I'm going to listen to the tail of this word right here and these right here on the uncompressed one more time. Okay, all right, now with compression.
Getting to know me. Sometimes I can't see past all the good, the bad, and the growing.
Man, okay, I think it sounds amazing. Like, I'm just about ready to write the check. This is really, really good. Hazel Rig, like, gosh, props. Okay, so I'm getting excited, and that's okay. That's okay. But to me, that's about all the compression I would use on a song like this. I'm not looking to hammer this down. I might do a little bit more, you know, to play with the attack a little bit here and there, or use this as the first, back it down just a touch, and then follow this with something like my Manly Variable Mu or a Gate Stay Level, something like that, with just a touch of that Variable Mu thing. And I think that the tube tone combined with the transparent control that we're getting from this would make for an amazing record. Okay. All right. So that said, that's Gloria Anderson. Now what I wanted to do, so what we've had so far is two women, right? We've had her very pure, bright tone. We've had Mackenzie that is a little warm with some punch. And then I thought it would also be good to bring up a male vocal. And let's hear it on a deeper register thing and hear how it treats the bottom end of the chest cavity of a male vocal. Because if it's truly not changing the tone, and we can hear that it's really not on the voices we've heard so far, I think we need one more reference, and I've got a good one for you. It's my friend James Dupre. Thank you, James, for allowing us to use your music and your voice. Remember, everyone, these artists that allow us to do this, any support you can throw them with some streaming or following them on social media is a great thing. All right, so that said, we're going to have the same kind of situation that we've had on the other songs. A little bit of EQ. He was tracked on a 47, so we had a lot of low mid richness there. And a little bit of de-essing that are the same, you know, on each of the two. So there's no trickery or tomfoolery going on. The only thing is, on the second one here, I do have the Hazel Rig V&E inserted. Okay, so let's check him out. And we're really going to hear the same problems as usual. We're going to hear that he's just not connected to the track whatsoever. Certain words are getting lost. Some are too loud. But also listen to his tone, okay? Because he gets some pretty deep spots going.
Forever sounds simple when it's wrapped up tight in a pretty rhyme melody. Even when you said you loved me all your life, it was just another fantasy.
Okay, now let's bring up the Hazel Rig and let's start dialing something in.
Forever sounds simple when it's wrapped up tight in a pretty rhyme and melody. Even when you said you love me all your life, forever sounds simple when it's...
You know what I'm going to... Okay, so what I've done is I've got it registering about 70 dB of compression. And, you know, some adequate makeup gain to make up the difference. But that said, I've got the fastest attack and the fastest release. Let's check that out.
Forever sounds simple when it's wrapped up tight in a pretty rhyme and melody. Even when you said you loved me all your life, it was just another fantasy.
Okay, not only is it doing, obviously, the incredible job that the V&E has done on the other two, it's just taking care of the dynamics for us. I don't know how else to say it. It just sounds great. You know, it just sounds like the singer is that consistent because I hear no artifacts whatsoever. But what I want to do is play the other one again, the uncompressed, and listen to the tone because I felt like his tone still sounded great. I was not hearing any bottom end buildup or lack of bottom end as a result of the compression.
Forever sounds simple when it's wrapped up tight in a pretty rhyme and melody.
With compression.
Forever sounds simple when it's wrapped up tight in a pretty rhyme and melody.
Yeah, all the rich bottom end is still there intact. It hasn't been thinned out. It hasn't been added to. Really loving it. Just maybe a little bit more apparent volume. But that said, what I want to do is I want to go up to the chorus. And listen, because he goes into a whole different gear in the choruses. And I kind of want to push this box to its limits, if it even has limits. I don't know that it does. So we read up to 15 dB of compression. I think I kind of want to, like, achieve it. And not only that, but be hitting often enough that we're actually getting more than 15 dB of gain reduction and see just how audible or inaudible the circuit is. Let's do it.
The world don't need another love.
Wow, that is amazing. Okay, so one more time, I'm going to remind myself of the chorus with no compression.
The world don't need another love song. Too many love songs don't come true. The world don't need another love song. And I don't need another life for you.
Just the problem we'd expect, right? The band is kicking butt. They sound incredible. And he doesn't sound incredible yet. He's singing great, but he doesn't sound like he's on the same stage as them. He doesn't sound like he's part of the band. Very separated, very, very disjointed. So now let's put the compression on and in turbo mode here with 15 dB lighting up fairly regularly. And let's hear it.
The world don't need another love song. Too many love songs don't come true.
That's flipping awesome. Okay, so what I did is I have the fastest attack setting. I just wanted to hear it at its most aggressive. And I have its fastest release as well. You know, on some of our favorite boxes, like an 1176, you know, using the fastest release settings is a way of getting more distortion. You know, if you need it on an aggressive rock thing, that chatter that happens, you know, that puts that upper mid-range aggression into it, you know, it's a flaw. It's a circuit flaw that we sometimes use to our advantage. I don't think the circuit has that. It doesn't have the flaw. There's no distortion to speak of. I mean, it's stunning.
The world don't need another love song. Too many love songs don't come true. The world don't need another love song. And I don't need another life.
I don't really know how else to say it. I think I've probably used all the adjectives and all the words over and over for every, you know, every artist, every genre. I mean, this thing is amazing. It really is everything that it's cracked up to be. You know, when the marketing hype is matching the performance, in my opinion. And now this is an expensive piece of gear. This is an investment. This is all handmade, best of the best components. it's a very high-end unit, so you're not going to get this thing at a steal. However, vocals get us gigs. I mean, the better our vocals sound in our finished mixes or our productions, our recordings, that's when that artist, that producer, that label, they just keep coming back to us and get us hired over and over and over. That said, I sure like money. I like getting hired and hired over and over and over. So I really am wanting to add this to my arsenal and make that investment. So we'll have to talk with my friends at Sweetwater. Sweetwater, speaking of them, they are sponsoring this video. So a huge shout out of thanks to them, because that really helps me. It goes a long way into to put video content like this out. I love hardware, as you can tell by looking around the room that I'm sitting in. And I have some very expensive pieces, you know, like from Manly, Solid State Logic, high, you know, very high-end gear. But I also have, as I'm looking around, some very affordable gear. I have a Warm Audio 1176 down here. That's something that is, you know, very cheap compared to a lot of the other gear that I see in the rack. So I want my videos to kind of do that. I want to focus on a lot of gear that a lot of you want to hear, whether it's a $10,000 vintage compressor or whether it is a $300 microphone. I want to make the videos that you guys want to see. So that said, if you want to see me do a review on anything specific, I wish you would leave me a little comment below and give me some ideas of some of the gear that you are really interested in, and we'll see what we can do. But if you will, just follow that little link on anything that you buy from Sweetwater, and it'll go a long way into helping this channel survive and thrive and keep videos coming your way. Okay, guys, thank you so much for watching. Happy mixing.